to you by the donations of our faithful partners.
Shalom. I'm Eddie Chumney of Hebraic Heritage Ministries, and we welcome you today to our study on the Hebraic roots of Christianity. We are doing a study series entitled Yeshua from Genesis to Revelation. And this is our last program in this series. This is program number 30. And in this program, we're going to explain the significance of Gog and Magog and how this battle is related and associated with the eventual reunification of the 12 tribes of Israel. Now remember, when we are studying the Hebraic roots of Christianity, we must keep everything centered on Yeshua the Messiah. Because it says in Psalm chapter 40, verse 7, "Then said I, Lo, I come, in the volume of the book it is written of me." And Psalm chapter 40, verse 7 is quoted in Hebrews in chapter 10 and verse 7, referring to Yeshua the Messiah, that Scripture speaks of him. In Luke, in chapter 24, and verses 17, I'm sorry, Luke chapter 24, verse 27, and verse 44, Yeshua said the following, "Beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the Scriptures the things concerning himself. He said unto them, These are the words which I spake unto you while I was yet with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the Torah of Moses, and in the prophets, and in the Psalms concerning me." So Yeshua said that the Torah, the prophets, and the Psalms is written or speaks of him. So we've been doing a series showing how this is so. First showing Yeshua in the Torah, and now we've been doing the last several programs on understanding and seeing Yeshua in the book of Revelation, as the book of Revelation teaches and explains the details of the uniting of the 12 tribes of Israel. That in seeing Yeshua in the Torah, we understand that Yeshua created the heavens and the earth, John chapter 1, verse 3, Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 and 16, that he made covenant with Abraham, Galatians chapter 3, verse 16 and verse 29, that Yeshua led the children of Israel out of Egypt and was the rock that was in the wilderness, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, and verses 1 through 4. He is the one who defeated Pharaoh and his army in the Red Sea, being the right hand, Exodus chapter 15, verse 6. Yeshua is the lawgiver, James chapter 4, and verse 12. And the lawgiver is also the bridegroom, because at Mount Sinai there was a marriage that was made between the giver of the Torah and the receivers of the Torah. That would be the house of Jacob or the nation of Israel. The receivers of the Torah being the bride of the lawgiver. However, instead of being faithful to their vows, the bride of the lawgiver, the house of Jacob or the nation of Israel, went after other gods, got scattered into the nations of the world. And we're told in Jeremiah in chapter 31 and verse 10 that he that scattered Israel will gather him and keep him as a shepherd does his flock. So who's the one that scattered the exiles of Israel? It was the lawgiver. It is Yeshua the Messiah that scattered Israel into the nations of the world. And so he is going to gather them. When he gathers them, he's playing the role of the good shepherd. And we're told that it's the Messiah who's going to gather the exiles of Israel in Jeremiah chapter 23. And it's Yahweh Elohim, the good shepherd, that's going to gather the exiles of Israel in Ezekiel in chapter 34. That's why Yeshua said in John chapter 10, verse 11 and verse 14, that he is the good shepherd. And he explained to the Jews or the Pharisees in John chapter 10, verses 16 and 17, that he's going to lay down his life, or he's going to die on the tree, for the purpose of taking two sheepfolds and making them one, of which he's going to be the good shepherd over. And this is repeated in John chapter 11, verses 49 through 52, where Caiaphas the high priest prophesied that Yeshua would die for that nation, John chapter 11, verse 51, but not for that nation only, but he would gather together in one the children of God scattered abroad. That Yeshua is dying for two nations, who are the children of God, who are scattered abroad, and to make them one. So Yeshua is dying to unite the 12 tribes of Israel. But before he physically gathers them, he has a greater problem, and that is that they've been unfaithful and broke the covenant. So he wants to restore the relationship. And the means by which he seeks to restore the relationship is he dies on the tree, sheds his blood, so that in doing so he can make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. And the word new in Hebrew actually means renew, that he's got to renew the covenant that he made at Mount Sinai with them. And in renewing this covenant, he's going to write his Torah upon their heart. The way he's going to write the Torah upon his people's heart is he's going to give them his indwelling Holy Spirit, which we see takes place in Acts in chapter 2. And in the end, it's going to cause the following to result. I will be their God, and they will be my people. That this is phraseology that indicates a marriage, that he is ultimately going to be wedded to his people. And the unification of the 12 tribes of Israel is likened unto a marriage. Now, the actual physical return of the exiles of Israel is going to happen in the end of days, in messianic times. Specifically, the gathering is going to be taking place during the tribulation period. And the period of time that the exiles of Israel are going to be gathered, the prophets refer to it as the day of the Lord. And that's the setting of the book of Revelation, Revelation chapter 1, verse 10. John said he was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. The Lord's day is the day of the Lord. Who is the Lord? It is Yahweh Yeshua. What is his day? It is the messianic era, messianic times. Now, each day in the Bible begins in an evening and it ends in the morning, as we're told in Genesis chapter 1 and Genesis chapter 2. So the day of the Lord begins in the evening, that is darkness, that is tribulation, and it ends in the morning. That is Messiah setting his feet down on the Mount of Olives and ruling and reigning with Israel, with the nation of Israel being a light to the nations and ruling over the nations. Now, during the tribulation, the nations of the world are going to divide the land of Israel, Joel chapter 3, verse 2, and the city of Jerusalem, Zechariah in chapter 14 and verse 2. That's just being fulfilled in our days through the establishment and the desire of the nations to create and endorse and support a Palestinian state. That will result in a rebellion in the land of Israel by those who will not be supporting this Palestinian state. And those who will rebel are those who believe in the Bible, those who believe in the covenant that was made with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, those who believe in following the Torah. This rebellion is the birth of the biblical state of Zion, who was born in one day during the tribulation, during a time of great travail, in Isaiah chapter 66 and verse 8. And with the birth of the woman who has a crown of 12 stars on her head, that's Revelation chapter 12 and verse 1, who during a time of great travail, Revelation chapter 12 and verse 2, she brings forth a man child who is to rule all nations. That's the Messiah. The Messiah is born and revealed to his people with the birth and the establishment of Zion. But with the birth and the establishment of Zion, his people flee into the wilderness. That means they leave the places of the nations of the world where they're living, and they actually flee in their local areas away from the cities into the wilderness, but it's the beginning of a process to return to the land of Israel. Now, those who are leading them back to the land of Israel is the 144,000. But those who are returning, they'll be returning from the nations of the world where they are living and scattered, and they'll be returning in camps or in groups, just like the children of Israel when they came out of Egypt.